concisely sums up the gospel. And that's found in John chapter 1. But I'm going to start back a little bit from where we usually pick up 16, but I'm going to go back to 14. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. We see Jesus is born into a world worthy of God's condemnation, worthy of his wrath. It is a spiritual war that he is born into. It's that we're born into. This is a world of disobedience and a world of pain, a world of suffering. I want to look at, as we look at Jesus in this context of pain and suffering, I want to look at him and who he is in Colossians 1, 15 through 20. It says, Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And through him to reconcile to himself all things that are on earth, or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. That is also summed up in Romans 11:36, which says, from him and through him to him are all things. Him, all things. Jesus humbled himself. And his example of humility is found in Philippians 2, read that as well, Philippians 2, 1 through 11, where he shows us his example. So if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from the love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being full accord and of one mind. Do nothing selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to grasp, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. And obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that in the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So this humility points to glory. It always points to the glory of the purpose. So, am I living a life of humility? Am I living with a servant's heart like Jesus? I have to ask myself that. And I hope that each one of us examines our hearts daily to look at how we're serving, how we're living. Is that what I'm reflecting? Or am I, summed up in verse 3 and 4, living a life of selfish ambition, not considering others more than myself. And so I wondered, how did Jesus maintain his servant's heart? It was through prayer. It was through constant prayer. How did he stay in a right relationship with his Father in heaven? I want to look at Hebrews 5:7-10. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. came to his God, his Father, our Father together in reverence and submission. And that's how we should always come before our Father in heaven, is in reverence and submission. His prayer is made with loud cries of tears. He felt pain. Said, out of both your heart and mouth speaks. So am I speaking with an attitude that Jesus had? Am I speaking words of hope and trust, words of encouragement, words of love and praise, words of gratitude? Because it's important what we say. It's important what we let come out of our mouth. Jesus shows us in John chapter 7, it says on the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and cried out, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. A stream of living water will flow from within you when you are walking in light as he is. But it is intentional. We have to focus on. I'm not speaking words of life and truth, then what am I speaking? Am I speaking words of condemnation? Am I speaking words of selfishness, of criticism, of gossip? Am I speaking words of complaint, of even impatience? These are things that I tromp around every day. I got impatience caked all over the soles of my feet. Nasty. You don't want to go in your house with mud all over your feet, do you? Let's don't go into the Lord's house carrying the burden and the nastiness of complaining. you angry, and why is your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. And its desire is for you, but you must rule over it. NIV says you must master it. Sin is crouching at that door. And it constantly desires to have us. But we must master it. We must master it. Jesus faced this same sin. Sin crouched at his door. Satan did his very best to trip Jesus up. Because he knew if he could trip Jesus up just once, he would be disqualified as the atonement on that cross. He knew it. He couldn't do it. It was impossible. I want to read Luke 22:39-36. And he came out and went, and as was his custom to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him, Jesus. And when he came to the place, he said to them, pray, that you may not enter into temptation. And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will. And they appeared to him, an angel from heaven strengthened. And being in agony, prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood, falling down to the ground. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping for sorrow. And he said to them, why are you sleeping? Rise and pray that you may not enter into temptation. It is real. It is all around us. Jesus is there interceding on our behalf. He is constantly encouraging us to rise, pray, be aware, be on guard. Our attitude in how we pray, a lot of times in the face of great temptation, great suffering, we lose a loved one, someone is shot, someone is killed, meeting a tree at a high rate of speed, we want to immediately rebel. God, why did you let this happen? How dare you take so-and-so from me? I think of Job. Job lost a lot. I don't know, many of us lose as much as Job lost in the very short period of time that he lost. It was a very concentrated attack. And it had to have weighed mightily upon him to lose not just the belongings, the livestock, his children, but lose everything so quickly. I can't even imagine. But his attitude that we must possess. It is only by the power of God that we're able to say, as Job said, as he arose and learning all that had happened, he arose and tore his robe, shaved his head, fell on the ground, worshiped. He didn't fall on the ground and complain. He didn't fall on the ground and say, God, how dare you? He fell on the ground and worshiped. He spoke the truth. He said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I shall return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That's a hard thing. It's a hard thing to imagine being able to do. I can't imagine that if I lost my son. Many of y'all who have lost loved ones. It's hard for y'all to say, let's do the Lord. Something to love with God. But we have laid out in God's Word for us. His Word shows us the way to have the attitude. We will look at 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. I didn't have that last part here, but you can never read too much God's word. Time spent in prayer, time spent in the word is never, ever time wasted. It's more important than anything else you do in any part of the day. I do want to touch on that. That giving thanks. Let's go back to Philippians 4. This is sort of a parallel, in parallel Thessalonians 4:9. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. Not rejoicing. Both of those begin with rejoicing, being joyful always. Joy is a fruit of the indwelling of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit in you produces that joy. And it is a characteristic mark of a Christian who has the firm hope. The firm hope of Jesus, the firm hope of the born-again believer whose identity is always and only found in Jesus. It's not found in their status, it's not found in their position, their job. It's not found anywhere else, it's only found in Jesus. That is where we find hope. Hope is in Him. The rejoicing is never dependent on our circumstances. Job was able to worship God in the face of extreme temptation to curse God. His very wife told him to go ahead and curse God. And not just curse God, but curse God and die. Like, no, I gotta have help you. Just get done with you. But no, Job did not give in to that. He worshiped. Blessed. Praying without ceasing, verse 17, Thessalonians 5. Praying without ceasing, praying continually. This is a constant communication of God. This is where we not only rest in His presence, but pray in His presence, glory in His presence, live in His presence. James 4:8 says, draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. He wants us to desire Him. He wants us to want Him more than anything else, more than His blessings. He wants us to desire Him with an intense hunger in our heart, an intense hunger for His Word, for knowing Him and loving Him. This is the deer pant for the water, so our soul is to pant for Him. We need to desire Him. And this is where we apply Romans 12. Romans 12. Verses 1 and 2, it says, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual act of worship. Which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to the image of this world. The image that says, curse God and die already. Cling to your 401k. All your assets, property, whatever. Do not be conformed to the image. Be transformed by the renewal of your mind. The renewing of your mind. That by testing, which is so necessary, by testing that you may discern what the will of God is, what is good and acceptable and perfect. I've heard it said in the will of God, discerning what the will of God is. We walk in the light, He is in the light. We have fellowship with one another, as we said in the first time. When we have the mind of Christ, That's where he wants us. That's where he wants us to reside, in his grip, in his presence. Giving thanks in all circumstances, verse 18. This is God's will for us. Having that heart of thanksgiving, having, as Uncle Pete said, an attitude of gratitude. Do we love God this much? Do we love him enough to be able to thank him in all things? And not just thanking him some people think that you thank God for pain. You don't thank God for the pain, but you thank him for the opportunity that it brings. Thank him for the opportunity and the growth that will come out. We have to be stretched to grow. From what 2 Corinthians 4, 17 to 18. 2 Corinthians 4 says, "For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal." Sufferings, pain, achieve for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. If we have a right heart, if we look with an eternal perspective, if we look to the Lord and praise him in advance for what he's going to do through it, with it. I mentioned my Uncle Pete and his son and family's here today. My cousin Brody is glad to be here. Because he passed over a year ago. And I so very clearly remember watching him dying with cancer in his intestines, his digestive tract shut down, could not process food, essentially just shriveled up. No way for him to process anything. But to watch him, even in that pain, even as he was suffering physically, to see him witness to the hospice nurses who were coming in to improve his his last moments of life, his quality of life, it's a wonderful ministry for him to do that. But I saw something even more powerful where I saw Pete feeding them. Pete was giving them the gospel. He was feeding them something of eternal value. They were helping him temporarily in his transition to his new home. And at the same time, he was feeding them something of eternal value. And that stuck with me. Can I do that? Or can I do that? Am I going to wait until I'm in the hospital to do that? Am I going to wait until I've got a diagnosis that's terminal? Or am I going to do it right now? This is where the rubber hits the road. If we truly love the Lord and God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, then this should be our first call. It's our attitude of prayer, the attitude of gratitude, of praying for God to give us those opportunities daily to be that witness. Lord, give me an opportunity to speak to someone. But even on that, I remember Pete talking about how he had not forgiven or seeked and not sought to be reconciled to his first wife, my husband. And I'm off the ground here had asked him over the years, did you ask why he did it? No, no, I said. He was active in prison ministry. He witnessed the man. He loved the Lord Jesus with all his heart, mind, soul, and strength. And Brandon asked him again. He kept asking him. He did it, you know. He asked why. He did it. Finally, he's in the hospital in the short rows, as we call it. Greg asked him again, and Pete said no, and Greg said, It's time. This doesn't even, you don't even crash it anymore. And so he did, praise God. not dealing with some area of sin in my life, and it just going to block someone else. You know, Peter had been praying for Kenley to know the Lord Jesus. He didn't pray for it. He did not know that his unwillingness to reconcile the procrastination and reconcile was a stumbling block. For that daughter, he had been carrying hardness in her heart against her daddy from a strong family. And so I pray.